I never met him actually, but I saw Gaudemont only once in my life in a lecture when he was sitting in front and I was sitting far back. But I think over the year, I can say that over the years, I at some or other point, I read every line of his book on sheaves. That for many years, this was a very useful source for me. On the other hand, I have learned a lot from French mathematicians, some of them being here. So it's an honor for me to be being invited to speak here. Thank you very much to the organizers. Let me maybe put here the very basic notations. F is a local field of residue characteristic P, positive P. Then G is the F points of a connected reductive group over F. Little k is my coefficient field, an arbitrary field of characteristic P. So everything in this talk will be representation theory in characteristic P. And so correspondingly by mod G, I mean the abelian category of smooth G representations in K vector spaces. And then D of G, as you can guess from the title, I will derive something at some point. So D of G will be the unbounded derived category of mod G. So complexes unbounded in both directions of smooth G representations up to quasi-isomorphism. So these are the basic notations. And so let me run you quickly through some background, even though, of course, I mean, this is known to you. Most of this will be known to you, but I also have to set up the notations, further notations. So I is any, for now, I in G, any compact open subgroup and then we can form maybe X, the compact induction from I to G of the trivial representation. So of course all with coefficients in K, I won't mention this again, which here of course is simply free vector space over the cosets, G acting by left translations. And then once we have that, that is a smooth, of course, smooth G representation. And then we can, it's a very big one, and then we can pass to its Hecke algebra, which is just the endomorphism ring. I think I just call it H, which is the endomorphism ring, G endomorphism ring of X, but the with the opposite ring structure. So to make X a left, a right H module. And then, as you know, there is a pair of you have a pair of adjoint functors between so mod H is simply, of course, the category of left H modules. And on the one side and on the other, we have our category of smooth G representations. And maybe I denote this by T for tensor and this for homology or cohomology. So if you have a module, right, we tensor it over H with our module X, which is a right H module, and then G acts on this via its action on X. And on the other hand, if we start with a representation, then we just take its I fix vectors, and to see the action immediately, we rewrite this by Frobenius reciprocity as the G homomorphisms from X into V. And then, of course, the action, right action on X induces a left action on this Hom space. Now, unfortunately, these functors are very badly behaved. Certainly in characters dp, for example, they are not exact. And if they are not exact, of course, it's not a particularly clever idea to think we should derive them. Well, let me say it this way, pass to a derived picture. But this does not mean that we simply derive them. It means more than that. So the first thing we do is we pick this category mod G, of course, the modules of a ring anyway have projective and injective objects. The category of smooth G representations is known and easy to show that it has enough injective objects. So pick an injective resolution of our X. I dot, so this is a complex, of course, one-sided to the right, unbounded to the right, complex, exact complex, apart from X, of course, of injective smooth G representations. So we pick such a resolution, and let me write to be clear in mod G. And again, form the endomorphism algebra, and again, form its endomorphism algebra. But this is now a more complicated object, so we take the endomorphisms again op. So this is a differential graded algebra. Because by an endomorphism, I do not just mean the endomorphisms of this complex, G endomorphisms of this complex, the usual ones, but the ones of every degree, right? We also allow endomorphisms which raise the degree, which do not go from ij to ij, but from ij to ij plus a certain degree, and this degree is encoded here. So that gives the grading, we get a graded object. And then the differential of I in on both sides induce a differential between the endomorphisms. And of course, the algebra structure is the opposite of composition. So this gives a differential graded algebra. Maybe let me say right away, this does not so I should maybe I say up to quasi-isomorphism. H dot does not depend, because it seems I have made a choice here, right? I choose there's no preferred injective resolution. But if I choose a different one, I get a quasi-isomorphic algebra. Does not depend on the choice of the injective resolution. I get a quasi-isomorphic algebra, and since we are only interested in the derived category of this one, then quasi-isomorphic algebras have isomorphic equivalent derived categories. So this is not really a choice. And then secondly, of course, the old algebra is just the degree zero cohomology of this one here, because the usual endomorphisms of an injective resolution up to homotopy correspond exactly to the endomorphisms of the resolved object. And I mean, degree zero, somehow the kernel of the differential here in degree zero, these are the usual endomorphisms of this, and then H zero is the quotient out by the image of the differential. This kills all the homotopies. Okay, and then there's the following theorem. So now I have to impose a assumption on I. Suppose that I is pro P and torsion free. Then we now, in this context, we derive the above functors. So we on the left side we have now the derived category of this DGA algebra, and here we still have our DG. And then I can, so the tensor product is right exact, so I have to derive it from the left. And on the other hand, the hom is left exact, so I have to derive it to the right. These then are quasi inverse equivalences of triangulated categories. Okay, so that's the motivation for what I want to talk about today. The assumption as such, in this generality, the assumption is not particularly strong, because you can always make I a little bit smaller to achieve these two additional properties in any p degree group. On the other hand, since I will, for the following, it is an assumption, because I will, I think more or less right now, in a moment, I will specialize to particular I's which do not in general satisfy this assumption. But let me maybe first, I can still put this here. So this H dot, of course, is a very complicated object, obviously, because it's a differential integrating. So to simplify things, we can pass to its cohomology algebra. So maybe I put this here. So the cohomology algebra of H dot is the same as the ext. So because here we can get rid of this injective resolution, this is just the ext algebra star of our original big smooth representation in this category. And then again, because this was a compact induction, by Frobenius reciprocity, this is the same as the cohomology algebra of our compact open subgroup with coefficients in this representation. So this is already a very a much more familiar expression. It has one big disadvantage, and most of what I will be saying later is somehow to make this useful thing anyway. I mean, here, the multiplication H dot induces a multiplication on the graded object. So we have here the intrinsic multiplication. And here, this turns into the opposite of the Yoneda product. Right, the concatenation of extensions. But it's not visible, I mean, because right x is only once here, it's no longer visible, directly visible on the cohomology of I. So that's what I want to talk about mostly. Certain structural properties of the cohomology algebra. So the this is joint work with Rachel Olivier. From now on I is one particular group. So from now on, I always, also in further sections, always is the pro P Iver Hoey subgroup. So I mean, the Iver Hoey subgroup was occurred already, and pro P means just it's the pro P pseudo subgroup of the Iver Hoey subgroup, which actually is a normal. I mean, because of the structure of periodic groups, is a normal subgroup of the Iver Hoey subgroup with a very simple quotient. And then in this section here. Also, let G be F split. So these are the assumptions for this section. I do not, for now, I will not, when I will, then I will specifically say it. I make no assumptions about, I mean, it's pro P anyway, by definition, but I make no assumption about torsion freeness. I mean, since the only thing one can explicitly work with is these cohomology groups, we have to use them to study the multiplication. And so let me introduce a little bit further standard terminology, of course. So in G, I pick a maximal split torus. Then in there I have the maximal compact subgroup, and in there I have T1, which is the pro P pseudo here. And what else? So then the corresponding let's see. Yeah, it goes the wrong way. So we have, of course, the extended affine Y group. It's a normalizer modulo T0. But we work with the pro P, we have to work with the larger quotient V tilde, which is the normalizer modulo T1. So this is the important group here. And then we have the Brüer-Titz decomposition. G is the disjoint union of these double cosets. And so you see this allows us immediately to write our X, right, which was the vector space over the cosets G mod I. We can decompose it into X W, W where XW, let me use this suggestive notation, is the induction only to this double coset. So it's the vector space over the IWI modulo I. And in particular, it's an I equivariant, right? This is I equivariant. And so the cohomology. Cohomology of profinite groups commutes with arbitrary direct sums, so is the direct sum. And let me abbreviate this by H star W, where maybe I put this, save some time. So. This is just the cohomology of I coefficients in XW. But what is this? So there's now we use Shapiro. Right? I mean, this is this here. And of course, before Shapiro, we can, I mean, this is a homogeneous space under I, so I can rewrite this as the H star I induction from I index W to I, where IW is the intersection of I and W is conjugate. And now I can use Shapiro. Shapiro's lemma, which says that this is the cohomology of IW with trivial coefficients. And actually, I mean, this is all very simple. If you go both things at once, then this is just on the coefficients, the evaluation map in W. So this is setting up the technical tool for the following. And so the basic, or maybe the first basic result about multiplication is the following, which looks, I mean, in some sense, it reflects something which is in the class in the underived Hecke algebra is very well known in its description by generators and relations, namely if you multiply two of these pieces here, so hj different degrees possibly, and v and w in v tilde, then you end up in a finite direct sum of all u, of course, in, maybe I write it this way, I u I is contained in the product of these two double cosets, h, and then the degrees add up, of course, u. So that's good, at least for the beginning. And now let me go through three structural results. So the first one is the usual Vahori or Propi Vahori Hecke algebra is known to have an anti-involution. And so is the so has the cohomology algebra. And the definition looks the definition is very elementary. Maybe at first you it doesn't look like it should be anything interesting, but maybe we do. Okay. Will I ever get this back down again? Anyway, I have one in reserve there. And that actually, this is the principle in all three cases. Yeah, right. In all three cases, is that when we do something looks kind of trivial, but it turns out to be relevant for the multiplication. So here we define this. Let's make this following very elementary definition. Define the K-linear automorphism J. So in this picture, I cohomology picture, A of H star X in the following way. So we do this on each piece. H star W, right? We use this Shapiro. This is the same as H star IWK. And then we just conjugate this by W. By W inverse, in fact. And we end up in H star. The conjugate of IW, I mean, you can do this in 2 seconds, by W inverse is IW inverse. And then we go back by Shapiro and have H star W inverse. And then the theorem says that J is an anti-automorphism of the cohomology algebra. Anti means, maybe I write it down because this is meant in the graded sense now, of course. So J of the product of two elements, there is a sign, right? Minus one to the product of the degrees of the two elements, J beta times J alpha. And the proof, I mean, I will not go in any proofs, but I will tell you in the second part somehow the technical instrument. So the proof comes from the second section here. So again, let me do something very naive. So the G equivariant map I have a map from X tensor X to back to X. Extremely simple. I have two functions, F tensor F prime, and I just map them to their pointwise product. Right, I view the induction as the elements here as functions of with finite supports, pointwise product. That's of course G equivariant. And this then gives me, together with the usual cup product, right? The cup product on group cohomology goes, I mean, you have, goes into the ten. The new coefficients are the tensor product of the old coefficients, and then we can use this map to go on. So, induces what I call here the cup product hi x. Tensor Hj Ix to Hi plus J I of the tensor product, but I immediately I compose it with this map, so I it goes back to Hi H some degree I of X. Now, so let me make a remark which seems to underline that this is totally stupid. This thing and this cup product under Shapiro. Corresponds to the usual cup product on the cohomology groups of these IW with red. If you have trivial coefficients, we have the usual cup product. So that's very easy to see, but it has, of course, the immediate consequence that this cup product is, it's completely component-wise. If I have HIV cup HJW, this is always zero if V is different from W. So why should this be helpful at all? But in some sense, then the second main technical statement so in some sense maybe the key technical proposition is the following, and I formulate it somehow vaguely, because this is in formulas this would be complicated, but I give you as a corollary one very nice and simple formula in a special case. Okay, so maybe I can put this here. I need some notation. I mean, we do know, right, for, let's say we have an alpha in HIV and beta in HJW, then by the, is it still somewhere? Should be still somewhere. By the first technical proposition here, we know that the product alpha times beta is the sum over these U in the product double coset, certain elements gamma U. And now the technical thing says that the gamma U can explicitly be expressed in terms of the cup product, this cup product, and cohomological uh, restriction and co-restriction maps. So this is really the tool which allows to compute the product. Let me give you, I find very nice instance of this. In general, this is a very complicated formula, but let's suppose that the two elements, L and V, that their lengths add up, so that the product element the length of the product element is the sum of the individual lengths. Then actually we only have, then the only possible U is actually the product element. We have only one term here. And for this, the product of alpha beta, so the nicest way to write this is the following. Alpha times tau of W cup tau of V times beta, where this is the standard notation here for the usual Hecke operators, right? Tau of something is the characteristic function of this, the double coset of something in the usual Hecke algebra. So this reduces right, the product here to the cup product and the modules, only the multiplication of the degree zero part on everything, which is, I mean, this is easy to describe. What is true is that if the lengths do not add up, then this is still for the highest term in here, this one still has this formula, but there are many complicated other terms then. Okay. So then let me see, is duality. So now I have to assume for the last two points here in this section, I do assume that I is torsion free. The reason for this is that the consequence of this here is by Lazar, an old result of Lazar, that all these subgroups, all these open subgroups, IW, are Poincaré groups of dimension D, which is the dimension of G over QP. You can view perhaps G, either you take the dimension as an algebraic group and multiply it by the extension degree, or, I mean, I should say that this torsion-free enforces that the field has to be of characteristic zero, yeah, the local field. Or you view it as a periodic Lie group and take its dimension as a periodic Lie group. So this means they have cohomology only up to degree D, right? So the immediate consequence, in particular, our cohomology algebra sits in degree zero to D. So it's zero for star degree bigger than D. And in, we will use this later, in the in highest degree D, all this, the cohomology of all these groups is one-dimensional. Plus, there is the cup product pairing is non-degenerate. For each of those, I don't write this down. So now we use another map. It's a very simple map. Have G equivalent map from X to K. We just, I call it sigma. If you have a function here, I just add up all the values, right? It has finite support, so I can add up all its values. And this induces, together with the cup product, let me write it out. So we first take the, our cup product. And then we take this map on the coefficients. And let me, so this is, let me this denote this for later use, capital sigma HDI little sigma. Ah, actually, I don't want to do this in general, right? I mean, we want to about duality. So I take here d minus I, then I have here h d, 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 I with trivial coefficients, and this I identify once and for all. I told you this is one dimension. I identify this once and for all with k. And then I can use this. Use this for duality, for this induces a duality map, right? So get K linear maps from HI X into H T minus I X linear dual. I write Czech for linear dual. So it's easy. Let's stick for a moment to this this cohomology picture. So these are, what is not difficult to see is these are injective with image. It's of course not surjective with image. All what we call finite linear forms. I mean, since this is the cup product, which was on each IW piece, the usual cup product, which is non-degenerate, this gives, of course, the immediately the injectivity. And it also gives, so finite just means a linear form is finite if it's non-zero on at most finitely many of these summands, HD minus IV. So this is all on the eye picture, but then the proposition is the following. So this map, so I'm going back now to the X picture, the above map is an isomorphism of H, H bimodules. So this is XI, of X, X. And this here, before the dualizing, is X, D minus I. Of X, I leave a little space. I have to put some decoration here in a moment. X, X. And of course, here the dual, linear dual, and then let me write, simply indicate this finite. So in the moment, I only have rewritten these two terms in the X language, and I consider the above map. This is, of course, also a bijective by what we know already. So the statement here is that the H bimodule action, which comes from the H action on these two terms, is reflected here by the H action on these two terms, but changed by the anti-involution. Yeah, where J on the left, X, denotes X made into A. X was a right, originally a right H module, so I make it now into a left. No, I always mix up, right? And it was a left module, right? H was acting from the right, so I make it into a what is the usual convention about? Left and right. I think it's now it's a left. Left H module via J, via the anti-automorphism. I mean, may more should be true, but we can prove this here. The whole, not only the H degree zero action on this from the left and from the right, it should be something like this should be true for the, I mean, the same statement in some sense should be true for the whole algebra structure, but this we can't prove yet. But this allows us, and I will show you in the last point D, I will show you this, the consequence, right? I mean, this will allow, put here D, then this is zero. Here it's the usual Hecke algebra, but with some twisted action. And since the usual Hecke algebra we know very well, and then we also know the twisted action very well, we can explore this to get some information about the structure of the top degree piece. So this is the, in this section, the last subsection, the top cohomology HD of H. And again, here, of course, if I want to apply this, I have to assume that I is torsion free. Maybe I abbreviate this because I want to, I have a still a last section. So maybe I do only the last fact. Let me write down one, but maybe I don't have the space here. Let me only write down the cleanest proposition. I have to make so assume that G is simply connected with irreducible root system. Then, so for the first part, I could, some of this is true in more generality, but for time reasons, let me put this all together. So then the top cohomology, right, we have this map. We have this map to the to K, actually the split. So this is the direct sum of HDIK, and let me put here trivial, plus, of course, then the kernel of this map, sigma, where the trif stands, the maybe this I put here right away here, this means as H bimodal, this is the trivial H, I mean the H structure on here is a trivial one, trivial H bimodal. But maybe I put here this separately. So this here is super singular. It's a huge super singular from the left and from as H module from the left and the right. So super singular here is somehow the analog of super cuspidal in the characteristic zero theory, maybe. Anyway, it is to formulate the last, maybe really most structural fact is I need, I mean, super singular, there is a certain ideal in the center of the Propi-Hivori-Hecke algebra, a specific ideal. And super singular means that a module is torsion for this super singular means the module is torsion for this idea. And then the last fact is that this super singular, very big super singular module. So then an obvious super singular module, finite dimensional one, is I just divide H by the ideal which this central ideal generates in H. And then the statement is, so I have this finite dimensional super singular module and I take its injective hull. Of H mod JH. Again from the left end and from the right. Okay. So far our structural results about the algebra. Now I want to talk about at the end in the last brief last section. I want to talk a little bit what I strangely maybe call derived parabolic induction. This is joined. Sarah Scharotzke. So let us pick a parabolic subgroup. And of course, I think it occurs to me I forgot to say this. When I introduce the torus, of course, there always has to be a relation between the torus. My Ivohori has to lie, so to speak, in the apartment of the torus, and also yet now, of course, with the P, there has to be a relation to the chosen Ivohori subgroup. And then, I mean, it's a very easy fact that the usual parabolic induction for mod G to mod G is exact, right? So there is nothing to derive. I mean, it's on the nose. It extends to a functor on the derived category.
You mean mod M to mod G?
Sorry, of course. So what I mean here is, of course, how do using the previous theorem, how do we describe this on the side of the derived Hecke algebra? So I will now, because I have to distinguish, right? So far my objects had no subscript. Usually, of course, when I will write now maybe H dot M or G, I mean, and so on, I indicate by a subscript whether I'm over M or over G. Now let me first reformulate some known thing. So define the H, which is HG, HM, so usual, the proper Ivo Hoyer algebra's bimodule, which I call X index G, P. And it's just, I take the parabolic induction of xm, and I take the ig invariance. And then, maybe I can put this here, have more space. Then there is this lemma, which is just a, maybe I write this here, reformulation of a result of Olivier and Vignaras. The diagram, maybe these are two diagrams made into one, mod G, mod M, sorry, mod H, G, and here mod H, M. Mod M, here we have parabolic induction. So here we had had this pair, in each case, this pair of adjoint functors, TG, HG, and similarly here, TM, HM. And here we have just the tensor product by this bimodule. And moreover, I think this is, so far I cannot yet explore this for the derived picture, but I think this is something probably very important. Moreover, this bimodule X, G, P is finally generated projective over, I mean, only on the one side, on the HM side over HM. Okay, so that's the picture, the underived picture. And so let me finish with the derived picture, which looks like a kind of a formal consequence. So now define, right now we need an H dot G, H dot M bimodule. Which I then, of course, call I dot subscript GP. And let's at first let's just imitate what we did above. I mean, right? There was the invariance, taking invariance is the same as HOM. G equivalent HOM. Then here, from the universal thing, so which is here the its injective resolution, into here leave a little space. The parabolic induction of the universal thing over M, the injective resolution there. So, I mean, that was actually my first attempt, which turned out to be completely wrong. So the one also has to resolve this first injectively. So this is right. I mean, the parabolic induction does not preserve injectivity. So although this is an injective complex, it's a parabolic induction is no longer. So I take an injective resolution, but the problem lies there. Let me come back to this later in my last sentence. And then maybe I actually, yeah, then the theorem is that we have diagrams completely analogous to this one. So d h dot g d g d m d h m dot, right? I mean, these were the left, the right. Let me maybe only repeat it here. This were the left derived, this was the right derived of this one, and correspondingly here, we have the trivial derivation of parabolic induction, and here we have the derived tensor product with this Y modulus. It's commutative. I didn't write it there, sorry. It's commutative. Now, as I said, this looks as if it would be a completely formal consequence. But there is a problem. There's a huge problem here. Namely, this is, so this means passing to an injective resolution. As G representations, so in mod G. I want a bimodule, right? From the right, I want the action of HM dot. So it acts on here, and then by functoriality, it acts on the parabolic induction. But if I take now some injective resolution in mod G, I completely lose this action. There's no reason why I should preserve it. And so that's the huge problem. One has to find, so one has to take specific, so I mean, one needs specific or a specific injective resolution functor in the framework of differential graded categories. It has to lift this whole thing. I mean, the derived category is in some sense the homotopy category of a differential graded category, which takes all these gradings into account. And one has to do this injective resolution business on the level of DG derived categories. DG categories, and I mean that this is possible is a theorem by Schnürer, Olaf Schnürer. Really non-trivial thing. So once you have this, then the thing becomes a formality. But without it, it would be hopeless. Okay, thank you very much.
Any questions? I mean, I probably should know the answer to this, but I mean, does this thing exist for characteristic zero representations of groups with regular p-adic groups?
Yes, but it's nothing additional because there these functors are exact. Right, the Ivohori pro P groups have no cohomology in characteristic zero, so the whole thing is just the usual Hecke algebra. There's nothing new happening there.
I mean, did you discuss such things in that paper of 2007, or is that?
No, I mean, made comments, yeah. Yes. I mean, the surprising thing is, of course, there in characteristic zero, as you, I'm sure you know, you do get, say, for the pro-P Ivo-Hori, you do get a equivalence of categories, but not with the full category of smooth representations, only those which are generated by its Ivo-Hori in pro-P Ivo-Hori invariants. Whereas here, I mean, the surprising thing is that under these assumptions, of course, the higher commodity, even right, I mean, you may have a representation, of course, in characteristic P, every representation has a non-zero Ivo-Hori pro-P Ivo-Hori fixed vector, but they don't have to generate the representation. Nevertheless, somehow the higher cohomology sees the representation, whether it's generated by its Ivo-Hori fixed vectors or not. This is in the characteristic P case. Yeah.
Are there arrows in the other direction in that theorem?
I mean, certainly, so for completely formal reasons, the right adjoint. Right, once you have, because of the equivalence, I mean, the usual parabolic induction has a right adjoint, which is left exact, and therefore you can derive it. So you have a right adjoint for this on the derived category. And since these are equivalences, you have a right adjoint here, and you can compute it. It's the home from this bimodule, the left home. The problem is with the left adjoint, the usual Jacquet functor is right exact, but it's not clear whether one can derive it, because for that you would need projective objects in the G representations which do not exist in characteristic P. So I think that's where this, I mean, probably this finiteness property reflects some finiteness property of this here, which allows us to see that this also has a left adjoint. But this I don't know yet.
So you mentioned that the formula gets very complicated when, but if you suppose, for example, length of V is 1,
length of V is,
head of V is 1, maybe you have some formulas?
Yeah, but don't ask me to write it down right now. I would have to look it up. Because you get then, right, I mean, if you have, let's say this is S here. Right, but the lengths do not add up. Then the possible U's are, I think, SW and omega W, where omega is of length zero. And you get terms, I mean, one of these terms, I think this one, is still kind of, I'm not sure which one. But you have to, all the terms occur, and they are complicated. I mean, at least so complicated that I don't know them right now without looking up in the paper.
Even for V is equal to W is equal to S?
Yeah, I mean, what? No. You have every omega even in that case.
If V is equal to W of length 1.
Yeah. Yeah, sure. Then you have S squared here, and you have omega S here. So you still have many terms.
No, but you take omega is equal to S. If omega is equal to S.
No, omega is of length zero in this case. I mean, right? I mean, I was just describing if this is of length one here, a reflection, what the possible U's are. And there is one, which S times W, and then there are Q minus one omega times W. And so you have them even if W is S as well.
there is no more questions, send the speaker.